Oh, praise God. Can you hear me all right? Does the sound come through all right? Okay, thank you guys. Well, this evening, I'm really humbled to be the mouthpiece for the Lord tonight. And I just pray that it would be His words, His intentions, His spirit that would be made clear to us tonight. Father, that I might decrease and that you would increase. Yes. And Father God, help me to erase myself and to make all room in place for your honor and your glory tonight. And we thank you, Father, for what you have to share with us, for your words of encouragement and exhortation. And Father, may they be inscribed upon our hearts, not just tonight, but Father, for every day of this year. For this is the first message of this year, and we pray, Lord, that you would instill it into our hearts and minds, that we might carry it with us all along. And I thank you, Father, for this church. I thank you for our pastor. I thank you for every person in this church, every single Christian brother and sister that we have the privilege of knowing and fellowshipping with. And we pray, Father, that you would be honored tonight through all that is spoken, all that is said, all that is quickened to our hearts and mind. We give you all the praise, the honor, and the glory. And Father, speak to us now as you would through your Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. So I want to share with you a message that the Lord has put on my heart that I truly hope will be an encouragement to you. Because here we are in a brand new year, amen, and I for one, and I know this is the case of a lot of people that we've been hearing and listening to so far this year, are excited about what the Lord has in store for us this year, for us, for His church, for His people. Indeed, as you've prayed, Pastor, for the whole world this year. This is the year of Jubilee. And so in order to grasp that spirit, in order for us to live in the time, to live in the spirit of abundance, to live in the spirit of conquering, the spirit of victory that Christ Jesus has won for us and came to give us, the abundant life that He came to give us, we want to start off this year right. We want to start off with a word of exhortation, a word of encouragement, reminding us who we are in Christ and how we are to stand, how we are to live, how we are to speak. And let me take you back. What I've entitled this talk is Living and Walking in the Victory of Jesus Through Our Words. And if we start out at the very beginning, we go to Genesis 1, 27. We see that God made us in His image. And He created the world. He created the universe. He put the stars in place. And when everything was ready, He said, let us create man in our image. Let us, by the way, not let me, let us. Who were the other two? All right, so let's not forget, we are a creation of the triune God, not of simply, you know, I used to think of this for a long time, God the Father Himself, but then the words, you know, sprang to life. When I read it again not long ago, He said, let us. Well, who's the us, right? So we are a creation of the entire triune God. And in each and every one of us, we carry a bit of each part of the Trinity, spirit, soul, and body. So we start out understanding that God made us in His image. Who is this God? This is a God Romans 14:7, who the Bible tells us spoke things that were not as though they were. There's a message there for us. Remember, we're in His image. He made us how He wants us to be. He made Adam and Eve to be as He would have them live and take dominion over the earth. Until what happened? They gave it up, right? Satan came along and to kill, steal, and destroy, and he stole that dominion from us, what is rightfully ours. So we see that we are as God made us to be, to speak things that are not as though they were. What do you want in your life for 2017? Where is weakness? Where is lack? Where is needed healing? Where is victory needed? Speak those things that you want into your life. And we're going to look at that much more closely as I wrap up this message. But right now, I'm just sort of painting the background for you. And can you pull up Romans 10, and let's go to verses 9 through 10 and then 13. I want to focus on verse 10 and 13. You keeping up, Willie?
Romans 10.
Yes, sir.
What verse?
Verse 9 and 10, and then we'll look at 13. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved.
That's good, bro.
Right?
Yes, sir.
Are you confessing? Are you confessing with your mouth? Notice this is the message of salvation, but the principle applies to every part of our lives. Speak, confess with your mouth, positive confessions, right? And by the way, this is a disclaimer. Everything I say here tonight, I have the humility to understand that Pastor Bob has probably spoken it and read it and preached on it a gazillion times before, so... I have no pretension of inventing anything here tonight. No pretension that what you're hearing hasn't already been said or heard. But through the repetition, right? We need to get it. I need constant repetition. I need constant reminders of these things, right? So let this be as a reminder to us tonight. All right, that's my disclaimer. Otherwise, it's a scary proposition to be up here and think I'm going to speak something you've never heard before. God forbid. So, verse 10, if you can go to that, Willie. For it is by believing in your heart that you are made right with God, and it is by confessing with your mouth that you are saved. So we see we have to believe, we have to speak, and what's the third thing? We have to act. Yeah, confess, but act, right? Can you go to 13, Willie? For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. So we have that assurance, that blessed assurance, that by confessing our belief in Christ as the Son of God, by calling on the name of the Lord, that he hears us, and we will be saved. Again, created in his image to confess, to speak what not as though it was. We were dead in our sins. We cried out to the Lord. We said, I believe, I receive, I speak the life of Jesus into me. And by so doing, we receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. We receive salvation. We receive cleansing of our sins. We receive healing that is ours, complete healing. We'll talk more about that in a second. So if you look at Proverbs 18:21, now that we've set the background of who God is and who he made us to be, his children in his image, like any good father, he wants us to live in his image. Proverbs 18:21, he tells us, he reminds us, life and death is in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. So what are we loving? What we love, remember, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. What are we loving? Are we loving life or are we loving death? All we have to do is listen to the words we speak. So when we, and I'm guilty, folks. First, I'll be the first to admit it. I don't always speak life, because the sin nature rises up in me and I get angry and I get frustrated and I say things I aren't not to be saying. Anybody else been? Okay. Thank you, Willie. I'm glad there's two of us. Right? So, but it's a constant reminder. This happens to be my favorite verse in the Bible, speaking, because I have the Lord has put on my heart such a conviction of watching the words I speak. I don't know why that is. It just one day dawned on me that I think also through experiences that we've had, people that we've met that have come along in our lives, the things we've experienced, the books we've read, the sermons we've heard, the people that we have been, that have poured into our lives, I've come to understand the importance of watching what we speak. And finally, Proverbs 6:2, Willie. If that doesn't get you, okay? I'm hammering it in, guys, because this is so important. If you have trapped yourself by agreement and are caught by what you said, go on to the next one, Willie, please. Follow my advice and save yourself. For you have placed yourself at your friend's mercy. Now swallow your pride, go and beg to have your name erased. We are snared by our own words. So are you getting the picture yet?
Oh, yeah.
As I've hammered this hard enough? Okay. Now, fast forward to New Testament. Look at the life of Jesus. Jesus said, I do nothing on my own. I'm paraphrasing, but we can look it up, Willie. John 5:19. I do nothing on my own, but what? What I see my Father do. I tell you the truth, the Son can do nothing by himself. He does only what he sees the Father doing. Whatever the Father does, the Son also does. Okay? So we have that assurance, we have that conviction. If Jesus told his disciples when they asked him, show us the Father, He himself said, well, you've seen me, isn't that enough? Jesus, like his Father, spoke miracles into existence. He fed the multitudes. He calmed the storm. He healed the sick. He cast out demons. He even spoke death to a fig tree. There's your Proverbs 18:21. Which is interesting, by the way, if you look at it, because it says, and those who love it will eat its fruit. Jesus didn't speak life to the tree. He spoke death to the tree because he didn't get what he expected from that tree. So there was no fruit on that tree. Jesus tells his disciples further, Matthew 17:20, please. He tells his disciples, speak to the mountain. You don't have enough faith, Jesus told them. I tell you the truth. If you had faith even as small as a mustard seed, you could say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it would move. Nothing would be impossible. Nothing would be impossible to us. We have to confess, we have to believe, we have to speak. Jesus tells us that the words he spoke, remember, we're created in his image, in God's image. What Jesus sees, does, he sees his Father doing, right? If you go to John 6, verse 63. So Jesus said again, I tell you the truth, unless you eat of 63, Willie, please.
63.
Yeah, 63. That didn't look right. The Spirit alone gives eternal life. Human effort accomplishes nothing. And the words I have spoken to you are spirit, and they are life. Further confirmation. Okay? So, now that we've painted that backdrop, okay? I'm reminded of Psalm 119:11. Who knows that one? That's a favorite verse, right? Your words have I hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. Psalm 119, 11, Willie. Thank you, sir. Psalm 119:11. Your words have I hidden in my heart. Well, what are the words? What did we just see the words are? They are? They are spirit, they are life, right? And so the word we hide in our hearts, what does John 1:1 tell us? In the beginning was the Word. And who was the Word? Amen, Pastor. So the Word being Jesus, we have hidden in our hearts words of spirit and life. Okay? So what words have you hidden in your hearts? Are they God's words? Life or death? Is it necessary for the heart? Well, the Bible tells us the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? That's out of Jeremiah. So my encouragement to you is to find the words of life that counteract the sinful deceit in our hearts, knowing whose you are and who you are. And you know what? Sometimes we just need to shut up. Rather than speak death, when we just say nothing. I'm always amazed at you know, in situations where we've all been in this situation where people say something because they just feel they have to say something. They can't stand the silence. They can't stand the quiet. And so we blabber forth things just to fill the air. Be still and know that I am God. Sometimes we just need to watch what we say and wonder if we need to say it. So, I want to read a passage to you from one of my favorite authors, from his book called Healing the Sick. It's by T.L. Osborne. I just recently discovered this book, and I'll admit to you, I've been reading it for a long time, and I'm still not finished with it, because it is so full of God's Word and God's Spirit. Pastor, you know this book, this author. This is a man who was a mighty man of God, who had revivals around the world, saw multitudes come to Christ, saw multitudes healed and brought into the kingdom. And he tells us about the importance of our words. Let me read this to you, if you will. He says, "You said that you could not do it. And the moment you said it, you were defeated. You said you did not have faith. And at that moment, doubt arose like a giant and bound you. Perhaps you never realized that to a great extent, you are ruled by your words. You talked failure, and failure held you in bondage. You talked fear, and fear increased its grip on you. Solomon said, you are snared, remember we just saw this, with the words of your mouth. You are taken captive with the words of your mouth. Few Christians have recognized the importance of their words and the place they hold in their lives. Our words form our confession of what we believe or do not believe. Whenever the word confession is used, some people automatically think of confessing sin, weakness, failure, but this is only the negative side of the subject. The negative confession of your sin was only to open the way to the positive confession of God's Word. Christianity is called the confession, according to Hebrews chapter 3. The Greek word, which has been translated profession in the King James Version, is rendered confession in other cases. And the original, or the word profession in Hebrews, is confession or acknowledgement in the original. What we confess, we possess. The Greek word from which the word confession is translated actually means saying the same thing. It means saying what God says. It means to agree with God in your testimony, saying what God says in His Word about your sins, your sicknesses, your apparent failures, your health, your salvation, your victories, or about anything else in your life. In other words, testify to or acknowledge what God says. I thank God for his faithful servants. I think of all the books I've read, the sermons I've heard, the songs I've sung. This is just an aside. The people who have witnessed to me, the people who have encouraged me and exhorted me in my life, I thank God for his faithful servants that have come along and helped me to get to where I am today. Not that I've arrived by any means, but you see, each and every one of us can be that person to somebody else. There are people in your lives that no one else can touch. And we become the faithful servants that God has put in their lives to show them Jesus. So whenever I read something like this, I just thank God for it. I say, Lord, thank you. Thank you that you gave life to this man. Thank you that your Spirit spoke through him, and that as a result of these books, I now can benefit from that word that was spoken to him, written down decades ago. And in the case of the Bible, centuries ago. Thank you, faithful servants. Jesus said, in my name they shall cast out devils. If the word of God means anything, it means what it says. God will do what he said he would do, and we can do what God says we can do. I think of Joseph Prince. Here's another fine, faithful servant of God. If any of you know him, he has a powerful ministry, huge church in Singapore. He also has a very funny accent. If you hear him speak, you know, it's amusing, but he has a powerful ministry of teaching God's grace. And as I was reading through his book one day, the word came to me, and this thought said, came to me, and I had to share this with you. It says, I wrote this down. It says, to say I am not worthy is pointless. It's a given. But to ignore or negate the fact that our sins, past, present, future, are all forgiven and forgotten is to diminish the infinite worth of Jesus' sacrifice. Think about that. What are we hanging on to that Jesus hasn't already paid for? That he hasn't already cleansed us from? And to negate that, to say, well, you know, I'm so-and-so, and I'm such-and-such, and that's just the way it is to negate the victory that Christ came to give us, the abundant life that he wants us to live. He wants us to live in the victory that he has won for us. Amen? Remember, what did God say to Ezekiel? Did he say, pray over the dry bones? Did he say, lay hands on the bones? He said, speak to the bones. He gave him the words to speak. And the bones took on flesh and lives were restored where once there was only a dead body. Willie, could you put up Luke 11, 53 and 54, please? Now see, the enemy understands all this. And if we had time, we could study about who the enemy is, the nature of evil spirits, the nature of spirits in general. We know that just as God uses people to accomplish his will, Satan spreads terror, death, destruction, and stealing. By whom? Other people. He will try and catch us in our own false professions to accuse us and to bring us down. And some of us are more than willing participants. Luke 11:53 and 54. As Jesus was leaving, the teachers of religious law and the Pharisees became hostile and tried to provoke him with many questions. They wanted to trap him. Ooh, what? Doing something? Going to the wrong place? Drinking the wrong thing? Eating the wrong food? Saying something they could use against him. The enemy is the same today as he was in the Garden of Eden. Spreading doubt, causing us to doubt, causing us to say things, profess things, confess things that have no room in our lives. And when we go along with it, whether we're negating who we truly are, whether we're speaking death to somebody else, by the way, if we're speaking death, who are we serving? Are we serving the Lord? We certainly aren't serving ourselves, but are we serving Satan, evil spirits, in their mission to bring somebody else down? So, brothers and sisters, in 2017, let's learn to speak positive. Positive confessions for our health, our victories, our faith, for exhortation, for love, and for encouragement. Remember, we believe, we speak, we act. Another favorite author is John Bevere. If any of you know him, he's on fire for the Lord. I love reading his stuff. And he says this: the bottom line is that walking in true holiness is more important now than ever before, because of the deceptive nature of sin that Jesus said would run rampant in our time. The overwhelming great news, however, is that God has given us the power through grace to live a holy life in the midst of corruption. We must be lights in these dark days for two reasons: for our own sake and for the sake of the lost. So the idea of living in victory, the idea of speaking, watching what we speak, so we can live in that abundant life, so we can live as he created us to be, is not solely for ourselves, but for those who around us, whose lives we touch, who are looking to us, observing us, searching, that we have an opportunity to share Christ with and to be the hands and feet of Jesus with. Now, I want to get you participating here. I want you to name out, just call out some things that we are fighting against things that are in opposition to us, things that we have to deal with, things that are negative in our lives, things that want to bring us down. What are some of those things?
World, flesh, and the devil.
Okay.
Idleness.
Okay. I heard idleness. Distrust.
Stress.
Okay.
Distrust, too.
Yeah, that's a good one. What else?
Anger.
Anger, okay.
Bitterness.
Bitterness, okay.
Self-worth is a tremendous problem in people's lives.
Okay.
They don't know who they are in Christ yet.
Go ahead, John.
Just saying there's a connection to their growth from one another.
Yeah.
So distrust.
It's a progression, right?
Well, stress can lead to a distrust. Distrust can lead to anger.
Yeah.
But more importantly, bitterness comes from holding in anger and not letting go of it.
Right. Anything else?
Donuts.
Huh?
Donuts.
Donuts. That works. What else?
Think.
Come on, Missy.
Busyness,
okay. Yeah. Not business, but busyness. Okay, what else?
Lust,
okay. What else?
Sickness.
Come on. What are the things that we're fighting against? Huh?
Fear.
Okay.
Fear. Fight against the Holy Spirit many times.
Self-doubt.
Okay, self-doubt.
Pride.
Pride, good one.
Mm-hmm. Human nature.
What else? Guilt? Yep. What else?
Unworthiness.
Jealousy, anger, strife, ill-tempered. Got the whole list of links.
All right. Finally we get there. Jealousy. Pride.
All the seven deadly sins. Shame.
Ego.
Yep. Okay. And we could go on, right? We could go on all night. Right?
Yeah.
Let's remember one thing. What is the name above all names? The name above all names. The only name by which we must be saved. Jesus conquers all. He's taken all this on himself. He's nailed it to the cross. And he tells you, Josh, Nicole, Pastor Bob, Willie, Rick, Missy, Linda, Doris, Mary, thank you. He tells each and every one of us, Hélène. I almost forgot my own wife. Scratch that part, okay? He tells us, he took that on for us. So for crying out loud, quit taking it back. It's nailed to the cross.
That's right.
Leave it there. Mm-hmm. I'm speaking to myself as well, folks. All right, this is us, okay? This is us. I don't preach. I haven't been paid to preach.
Yeah.
So we're living under the blood. We're living under the name which has saved us, which has paid the price for us, which has sanctified us, thank you, which has justified us, which has provided healing for us.
Yes.
So brothers and sisters, this is my exhortation to us this year, 2017. Let's walk in that victory.
Yes.
Okay? Let's walk in that victory that Christ came to give us at so precious a price.
Yes, right.
The best that heaven could offer was offered down to us. God kneeled down, laid his baby son in a manger, helpless, to a sinful world. And he conquered. He said, in this life you will have trials and tribulations. But what? Be of good cheer. For he, the baby in the manger, rose up and overcame the world. He rose up from the grave and conquered death. And so we live in the blessed assurance that he is in us. He abides in us as we abide in him. Amen?
Amen.
Now listen. For everything that ails us, that comes against us, and healing is often something that we all deal with, there's ways of praying. There's ways of conquering. There's ways of speaking what we want. There's ways of confessing what God has already said and given us to live and walk in. This is from Derek Prince. I'm sure many of you know Derek Prince. Listen to this. He says, by this I overcome the devil. We overcome Satan when we testify personally to what the Word of God says the blood of Jesus does for us. Through the blood of Jesus, I am redeemed out of the hand of the devil. Through the blood of Jesus, all my sins are forgiven. Through the blood of Jesus, I am continually being cleansed from all sin. Through the blood of Jesus, I am justified, made righteous, just as if I'd never sinned. Through the blood of Jesus, I am sanctified, made holy, set apart to God. Through the blood of Jesus, I have boldness to enter into the presence of God. The blood of Jesus cries out continually to God in heaven on my behalf. That's the kind of speaking I'm talking about. That's the kind of prayer of confession and of taking back what is rightfully ours. Blessings, prosperity, healing, restored relationships, all of the blessings that Christ came to give us and that God wants us to walk into. You know, I've got more I could go on, but I think I want to close in prayer. Because there's somebody here that needs to hear this. And I want to pray today that all of us, matter of fact, why don't we all join hands? Come on. Let's get up. Let's all just make a circle here and let's join hands. Let's pray a blessing for 2017. Let's pray that Christ himself would manifest himself, be made strong and vibrant in us, for as we abide in him, he abides in us. We are to walk in that blessing. We are to receive the blessing that Christ wants for us, that he came to die on the cross to give us, that Father God, his Father in heaven, with so much love for each and every one of us, deemed fit to put down into the earth. And so we want to walk in that blessing. We want to receive the gift from God tonight. We want to receive his blessing. We want to receive restoration. We want to receive healing. We want to receive victory that is ours on already. Christ paid it all. It's ours. It's ours. We need to claim it, walk in it, receive it, believe it, speak it, confess it, and live it in our lives. Oh, Heavenly Father. Oh, Holy Spirit. Oh, Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we are in all of who you are. We are in all the love that you have for us. We are in all of who you are and who you have made us to be. For you have made us, Father God, in your image. We want to live in the truth of that image. Father God, help us, Lord, to believe, to receive, and accept the gift that you have given us. To realize the power of Christ who lives in us, who abides in us, Father, even as we seek earnestly to abide in him. Christ Jesus, our Lord, our Savior, Redeemer, our Prince of Peace, who came that we might be called sons and daughters of Christ. Sons and daughters of the living God, sons and daughters of the kingdom, ambassadors of Christ, bearing the aroma of Christ, having the mind of Christ, Father God, help us, Lord, to live in that reality that you have brought to give us. Help us to awaken to the truth of your word in us. Hallelujah. Father God, I pray now your special anointing, your blessing upon this church, upon each and every one of my brothers and sisters gathered here tonight, and all of the members of our church body, Father God, and all the members of your church around the world today and to this night and this year, that we would be blessed, that we would be awakened to the truth of who you are and who we are in you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father God, I pray for restored relationships. I pray for renewed joy in our hearts. I pray for restored finances where there is lack. I pray for healing where it is needed. I pray for prosperity, Father, not that we might be have more, but that we might be a bigger blessing to those around us, Father God, that we might be truthful witnesses to you, that we might be vibrant and alive, powerful witnesses, Father God, to those around us who seek you, Father, who have need of you in their lives, who seek and hunger for salvation, for truth, for light in the darkness, Father God. I ask, Lord God, that you would touch each and every one of our hearts to make it strong, to make it vibrant, to make it alive, that your honor and your glory, your praise would go out, would be made manifest in our lives. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Pray now, my brothers and sisters. Pray for what God is going to do in your lives. Receive from the Lord. Sharabababala, rombabababala, la la la, kumbabababa. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Father God. Thank you. Receive from the Holy Spirit. Receive from the Lord God, your Father in heaven. Receive from the Lord Jesus Christ, who loves you as his brother and sister, who lives in us as we live in him. Receive from the Lord Christ Jesus, who won the victory for us, who said the words, "It is finished," because the work was done. We are to live in it, to breathe it, to receive it, to walk in it, and to believe in the victory, for we are more than conquerors. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. In Jesus' name, we give you all honor and glory and worship and blessings and adoration. We say thank you, Father God. In his mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.